Hello, and welcome to Field Lab Earth, the podcast that's all about past and present advances in the fields of agronomic, crop, soil, and environmental sciences. Today we'll be talking to Dr. Rachel Malinger about confection sunflowers and insect pollinators. Do sunflowers bred to be more independent of insect pollinators still get a boost from bee visits? Which bees visit sunflowers? What's a confection sunflower anyway? Answers to all these and more coming right up. I'm your host, Abby Morrison. Let's talk about science. Hi, Rachel. Welcome to the show. How are you doing today?
Hi, I'm doing well. Thanks for having me.
We're so glad to have you with us. Why don't we just launch in and you can tell me a little bit about yourself, kind of your background and how you got to your science.
Sure. So I'm currently an assistant professor of entomology at the University of Florida. And I did my undergraduate in Michigan at a liberal arts school where I studied biology. And then I went on to get my master's at the University of Wisconsin-Madison in agroecology and entomology. So it was a joint degree. And I stayed there for my PhD at UW-Madison, where I got a PhD in entomology. And then I moved to Fargo, North Dakota, where I did research as a postdoc for about 2.5 years before moving here to Florida to begin my position in November. So I've only been here for a few months, but enjoying it so far. And in general, I'm interested in bees and in interactions between bees and plants and in plant pollination. And more specifically, I'm interested in the bees that we hear less about. So the native wild bees or the non-honeybees.
Excellent. And we're going to be talking about their interactions with sunflowers. Can you just give us kind of a high overview summary of what's going on with sunflowers?
Sure. So sunflowers are grown primarily for oil, and they are native to the United States and to North America. So it's a native plant, and it's been bred for a long time, for many decades, been breeding sunflowers to grow them primarily for oil, but they're also grown for fresh eating, baking, and as bird seed. So the sunflowers that you get in a gas station, those are the fresh eating sunflowers, and you can also buy those in bags to bake with. So they're grown here in the United States, primarily in the Great Plains, in the Dakotas. North Dakota and South Dakota produce the majority of sunflowers, but they're also grown in Kansas, Nebraska, Texas, and other states in the West. They're also grown worldwide, so even though they're native to North America, they're grown in Russia, the Ukraine, Turkey. So a lot of those Central European and Asian countries grow a lot of sunflowers, as well as some Mediterranean countries as well, like Spain. So they're grown worldwide. Oh, they're also grown in South America too. So in Argentina and other areas of South America, they grow a lot of sunflowers. So it's really a global crop, and it's a really fun and interesting plant in which to study plant-pollinator interactions, because in the wild, sunflowers are really dependent on insects to set seed, but we've bred them to be less dependent on insects. We've bred them to be more self-fertile. So there's some interesting differences between the wild sunflowers and the cultivated or domesticated sunflowers.
Can you tell me a little bit more about the pollinators you're working with specifically, the differences between them and other bees, wasps? What's going on with those?
Yeah, so in North America, again, sunflower is a native plant. So it has co-evolved in North America with many different pollinators, primarily bees. And most of the bees that visit sunflowers are solitary, and they're relatively large-bodied, although some of them are quite small. And these bees are different from the honeybee. Most people are familiar with the honeybee. In the United States, the honeybee is only a single species, and it's not native to the United States. So it's a single species native to Europe, and it's a social bee. So as many people are familiar with, it has large perennial colonies. There are workers and queens. So in contrast to that, many of the bees that visit sunflower in North America are solitary. Each female has her own offspring. There are no large colonies. And many of these bees that visit sunflower also nest below ground. so they don't nest in these above ground hives like honeybees, but they rather nest in tunnels below ground. So these are the most frequent visitors to sunflowers, these solitary ground nesting bees. But sunflowers are also visited by flies and wasps and other insects.
Do you have a favorite kind of bee?
Well, that is a really tough question. Bumblebees are very charismatic. Bumblebees are not the most frequent visitors to sunflowers. So of the sunflower visitors, I really like this one bee. It's often called a sunflower bee or the sunflower bee. Its Latin name is Sevastra obliqua. And it's a very large-bodied bee, very hairy, and I think it's really pretty to watch it visiting sunflowers. So that's a great sunflower bee, but I also really like bumblebees because they're just really fun to observe, and they're very charismatic.
Yeah, they're super adorable. So moving on to your work, can you tell me for this research kind of what your high-reaching goals were for this project?
Yeah, so the overarching goal was to look at the benefits of insect pollination for sunflowers. So I mentioned that we know wild sunflowers are really dependent on insects to set seed. But for the cultivated domesticated sunflowers, they've been bred to be more self-fertile, to self-pollinate and be less dependent on insects. And more of the research in sunflower pollination has been done with the sunflowers that are grown for oil. And less research has been done on the sunflowers that are grown for fresh eating, or the confection sunflowers. So we wanted to specifically study the confection sunflowers, the fresh eating sunflowers, and look at how insect pollination benefits yields or increases yields of these confection sunflowers. And then a second goal was to see how that varies across different sunflower cultivars or varieties. So as in many crop plants, there are a lot of different varieties of sunflowers. And these varieties all have different genotypes or genetic makeups. And so the role of insect pollination could vary across those. And then thirdly, we wanted to document which pollinators are most frequent and abundant for sunflowers, particularly in North Dakota, which is one of the main sunflower producing states.
So for these research goals, you kind of had three different experiments. Can you walk me through what you did for each of those experiments?
The first experiment was broadly looking at the effects of insect pollinators on confection sunflower yields, and also looking at how those effects vary across different plant genotypes or cultivars. So for that, we planted 15 different confection sunflower genotypes or varieties. And we planted these all in North Dakota, and we had multiple replicates per confection sunflower variety. And within each variety, we bagged some heads so that they were excluded from insect pollinators during bloom, and we left other flower heads open to insect pollinators. And what we used for this was this fine mesh that shouldn't exclude light or water, but does exclude pollinators. And we only bagged the heads during bloom. So outside of bloom, all the heads were open, and then during bloom, we bagged some of them and left others open to insect pollinators. And then to look at the effect of insect pollinators on yields, we harvested all of these heads and measured seed mass per flower head. And to do that, we basically took the flower head and we rubbed it against what's called a thresher, which removed all of the seeds. And then there's a vacuum attached to that, and that vacuum pulls up the unfertilized or unpollinated seeds and leaves behind only the ones that have been pollinated that are heavier and filled with seed. And so that way we can look at the total mass of pollinated seed per sunflower head, and we can compare heads that were open to insect pollinators with heads that are closed to insect pollinators.
Can you tell me more about what this vacuum thresher looks like? I mean, is it big? Is it gnarly looking? It sounds pretty intense to me, but I don't really know. So can you describe what that looks like?
Well, it does look somewhat gnarly looking. So my boss or supervisor, the senior scientist on the project, he calls it the Hellraiser. And it's basically a ball that has sort of knobby screws. And when it's turned on, it spins very fast, and you rub the sunflower head against that, and those knobby screws spinning at a high speed will remove all of the hulls. The hulls are basically, when you're eating the seed, what you would crack open and then spit out. So you put the head up against this and it spins around and it removes all of the hulls. Some of those hulls have filled seed inside of them, and so they're heavy. Other hulls do not have seed inside of them. Those are the unpollinated ones, and those are light. And so attached to this spinning ball is suction from a vacuum, and that will pull up all of the light hulls that were unfertilized or unpollinated, and it will leave behind, they'll basically drop into a bucket, the heavier ones that were pollinated. And so you're left with a sample of only the pollinated heavy seed.
Wow. That sounds intense.
It's fun. It's tedious to do for many, many flower heads, but it's a lot faster than with a forceps plucking individual seeds and weighing them. You know, it's a faster way to harvest and process.
Yeah, I'll bet. How long has that been around?
That's a good question. This particular model is fairly old, so at least a few decades. We also have another model that is probably some decades old, but right as I was about to leave the USDA, where I was working to do this project, they got a new model, which was fancier and bigger. And so there's always new technologies and new models coming out. But I think something like this has been around for many decades now.
Wow, that's wild. I can't imagine being the inventor for that. That sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, I don't know exactly when it was invented, but it, you know, the older varieties or versions don't look particularly novel. And then there's these, or particularly new, there's these kind of fancy, shiny models that are always coming out. So
sure. So then while this experiment was going on, there was also a second experiment going on. Can you tell me about that one?
Correct. So the second experiment, we planted a subset of the 15 varieties. So we planted 10 for this. And in those 10 varieties, we looked at visitation rates by bees. So I mentioned that sunflowers are visited by other insects like flies or wasps, but bees are really the primary pollinators. They visit most frequently. They're the most abundant. So we looked specifically at bee visits to these different 10 varieties. And for that, we walked through two adjacent rows per variety. So each variety had two rows planted next to one another. And we walked through that pair of rows and we counted the number of bee visitors. And we also counted the number of flowers in bloom. And we did two walks per variety. And each variety was planted twice. So it was a total of sort of four walks per variety per observation day. So we had a lot of data about the number of bees and the types of bees that visited these varieties. We also harvested heads that those bees visited and processed them in the same way using the spinning ball with the vacuum attached to it. So we processed those flower heads in the same way, and we looked at seed mass on those flower heads. And we did that so that we could relate the bee visitation rates to seed mass. And the question, the overarching question there was, do varieties that receive more bee visits have a higher seed mass?
How did you know whether or not it was the same bee that was going from head to head? Did it matter at all? If it was, did that affect your research at all?
So that's a good question. And basically what we were most interested in was, do bees prefer some varieties over others? And do some varieties get better pollination than others? And so in the end, we decided that it didn't really matter if it was the same bee visiting that variety over and over again, or even if it was the same bee spending a lot of time on a flower head. When we walked through the variety a second time, it could have been the same bee that we counted the first time just hanging out on the flower head. And regardless of whether it's the same bee visiting over and over, or a bee spending a long time per flower head, or different bees visiting over and over and over again, all three of those can result in greater pollination. And so regardless of which one it is, it's still an indicator that that variety is receiving better pollination, and possibly also that that variety is more attractive to bees. Because if it's more attractive, the same bee might visit over and over again, or a bee might spend a greater amount of time on that variety.
Can you describe the environment that you were doing these experiments in? Were you outside in a greenhouse?
All of these experiments were done outside, and they were done at a research station about a half hour from Fargo. At that research station, we had two blocks, So these varieties that we planted, it was replicated in two different blocks, and that was all on the property of this research station. So I think a good next step would be to take this to individual farmer fields and to see how insect pollination increases yields in farmer fields. But for this experiment, we did it all at a research station that was about half an hour from Fargo, North Dakota.
All right. And then you had a third experiment. Can you tell me about that one?
So the third experiment was generally related to our first experiment, which again, our first experiment was, do insect pollinators, specifically bees, increase yields? And so for that, we had these heads that were bagged to exclude insect pollinators, and then we had heads that were open. And one question that always comes up is, well, if you find seed set is reduced in the heads that are bagged, is that because of insect pollinators, or is it because the bag changes the conditions around the flower head, changes the temperature, changes humidity, changes water, moisture, etc.? And so what we did is we planted five varieties just so that we could do this over more than one variety. So we had five varieties that were a subset of the 15 we did for the first experiment. And in these five varieties, we had flower heads that were open to pollinators, just like we did in the first experiment. And then we had heads that were bagged and excluded from insect pollinators, just like in the first experiment. But the difference is for those bagged heads, every single day during bloom, we removed the bag and we did hand pollination. And we did this by rubbing two flower heads of two different varieties together. And this results in cross-pollination. So we have two different varieties that are both producing pollen. You rub them together, and that provides good cross-pollination. Immediately after doing that every day, we would put the bag back on. So these flower heads were bagged pretty much for the whole time during bloom, except for the minute per day when the bag was taken off and they were hand cross-pollinated. And so what we wanted to see is, if we can get good seed set in these bags through hand cross-pollinating, that tells us that the bags themselves don't have a negative effect on seed set, that it's really the reduction in pollination that is affecting seed set.
And what was the logic behind the cross-pollinating versus pollinating with the same variety with this?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the logic behind that is wild sunflowers, I mentioned that they're dependent on insect pollinators. And that is because they're genetically self-incompatible. So they can't set seed with their own pollen. They have to be cross-pollinated. So that's sort of the natural default pollination system for sunflowers. We've bred them to be more self-compatible, but there may still be some self-incompatibility, meaning that seed set is not optimal. You don't get the highest yields when they're pollinated with their own pollen, but rather yields increase, seed mass increases when they're pollinated with something that is genetically different. And so we did the cross-pollination just so that we were doing absolute maximum best pollination. And we did that so that we could see if, when those plants receive best pollination, do they set good seed, even though they have a bag on them during bloom. We wanted to basically make sure that those bags weren't affecting seed set, even if they're adequately pollinated or best pollinated.
Sure. Yeah, I guess that makes sense. Bees probably don't really care about making sure everything is within the species.
Right, exactly. So some bees are more likely to fly across rows. Often farmers will plant a particular variety in a particular row, and for different cropping systems, this is true not just for sunflowers. Farmers might plant a variety in one row and another variety in a different row, and some bees are better at crossing rows and cross-pollinating than others, but in general, bees, as opposed to something like gravity or agitation, are the ones that do that cross-pollination because they move across plants that are genetically different from one another.
Wow, I didn't know that at all about the different varieties in the same row, or different rows.
Yeah, that's particularly true for, say, something like apples. Apples are very genetically self-incompatible. They can't set fruit with their own pollen. And so farmers will plant different varieties within the same field and hope that bees will forage across those varieties.
So if these plants are cross-pollinating, how do you know that the seed that you're going to get out of them is what you're hoping to get?
That depends a little bit on what you're hoping to get. So if what you're hoping to get is a seed that you consume for oil or baking or fresh eating, then the pollen, the genetic makeup of the pollen, which plant is donating the pollen doesn't matter, because those qualities that we're interested in as consumers, like oil content or taste, etc., those are controlled by the plant that produces the seed, and they're not going to vary with the type of pollen that pollinates that plant. But if what you're interested in is producing seed that you can then plant in the ground and grow another plant, then the genetic makeup of the pollen does matter. And so when we're producing seeds that are then planted by farmers, then we do need to have controlled cross-pollination. So for sunflowers, in fields that produce seed, these are called seed production systems, they do have ways of controlling the pollen. So they might only plant one particular variety that donates the pollen, and the field is isolated from all other pollen sources. Or in some cropping systems, they'll even do the seed production under tunnels so that you can make sure you know that no other pollen is getting in there. So if what you're hoping for, what you're going for is seed production, then it does matter what the genetic makeup of the pollen is. But if you're just trying to get seed that you can consume for oil or fresh eating, those traits are controlled by the plant that's producing the seed, and it doesn't matter what the genetic makeup of the pollen is.
That's great. I had no idea about how all of this works.
Yeah, it's really fascinating.
Yeah. Hey, everyone. I hope you're enjoying today's episode. Interested in learning more? Rachel's article, Benefits of Insect Pollination to Confection Sunflowers Differ Across Plant Genotypes, published in Crop Science, will be freely available for the next 2 weeks on our digital library. You can find a link to it in our show notes. Let's get back to the show. So what did you find with your experiments? What were your results?
So for the first experiment, overall, we found that there was approximately 25% increase in seed mass when flower heads were open to insect pollinators versus bagged or closed. But when we looked at these results across the different varieties, we found that there were differences in that 10 varieties did not show a significant effect of insect pollination. So the yields for those 10 varieties were not different between open heads and closed heads. But for 5 varieties, we saw significant increases in yield when those heads were open to insect pollinators. And that ranged from 30% to over 100% in these 5 different varieties. So basically, the conclusion there is that some varieties are more dependent on insect pollinators than others, or some varieties benefit more from insect pollination than others. And then for the second experiment, looking at bee visitation rates, we found that bee visitation rates do also differ across these different hybrids or varieties. And we think that those differences in bee visitation rates are why some varieties benefit more from insect pollination than others. So we basically found that the bee visitation rates differ across the varieties. And when we compared bee visitation rates to yield, we found that bee visitation rates significantly increased yield. So the varieties that received more visits by bees had greater yields.
And what kind of bees did you find?
Yeah, so the most common bees were these solitary ground nesting bees, and in particular, 2 species of longhorned bees. And these bees are very abundant and common in North Dakota and in sunflower systems. We also did find another solitary ground nesting bee that is a sunflower specialist, and that's the one that I mentioned earlier, Sebastra obliqua. We also found that. And we found some smaller-bodied native wild bees. We did not find many honeybees, and this was despite the fact that we had a beekeeper bring honeybees out to the field. So very few honeybees visited sunflowers, but a lot of native wild bees, in particular these ground-nesting solitary longhorned bees.
Why are they called longhorned bees?
Well, they're called longhorned bees because the antennae are long, and this is particularly true for the males. So males of these species have very long antennae in comparison to other bees.
Did you have a lot of other pollinators visit? I know you weren't really counting those, but did you see a lot of that?
Right. We really did not. And that was somewhat surprising to me. So we found some butterflies, but not very many. We found very few wasps. We did see some syrphid flies, so these flies are ones that do commonly visit flowers, but really the visitor community was dominated by bees. And I think for some of these, like perhaps for some of the wasps or bees, they may be avoiding flowers that are really attractive to bees. And so there might be some competition or avoidance going on there. It would not be uncommon to see a sunflower head with 6 different bees on it at the same time.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. So
that's a lot of bees.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So if you're an insect that can go visit something else, then maybe you would prefer to do that.
Yeah.
Some of these bees that visit, like the sunflower bees, Faster obliqua, and the long-horned bees, they are specialists of sunflowers or asters more broadly. And so they're really attracted to sunflowers and related asters.
Yeah. Do they fight at all when there's that many bees around?
So I have seen some aggression. It tends to be between males and females. So sometimes males will try to mate with a female and the female will push the male off, or between males. So I don't see as much female-female aggression, but I do see male-male and male-female aggression.
Okay. So it's not really pollen fighting.
Right, right. It seems to be more about mating. Yes.
Sure.
But we also have a lot of floral resources there for them. When a sunflower field is in peak bloom, there's a lot of pollen and nectar. So you might see more female-female aggression in systems where pollen and nectar are more limited.
Yeah. Sounds beautiful. That just sounds amazing.
It is. It is.
All right. What about experiment 3? What did you find with that?
Yeah, so experiment 3, the results were encouraging. In general, we were trying to test or make sure that these bags didn't affect seed set apart from excluding pollinators. And we found that when we had bags but hand pollinated, seed set was equal to the heads that were open to pollinators. There was no significant difference. So this means that when we see a reduction in seed set within bagged heads, that's due to a reduction in pollination. And it's not due to something like a change in temperature, light, or humidity, because those bagged heads that were hand pollinated did get very good seed set.
Can you tell me some of the practical implications of this research and just kind of why this wild bee research is so important?
I think that one of the implications of this research is that for farmers that are growing confection sunflowers, they should care about pollination. And this is novel, or this is newsworthy, because, as I mentioned, sunflowers have been bred to be self-fertile, and many farmers think that they don't need insect pollination or that insect pollination isn't going to affect their yields very much. And what we've showed is that it does. And so farmers should be aware of this, and they should be managing their fields for increased pollination or adequate pollination. And so this might mean, for example, trying to conserve or enhance bees around the crop field or within the crop field. It may mean bringing in managed pollinators. So we didn't find that honeybees did much pollination here. Maybe in some other context, they would do more of the pollination, or maybe you can bring in alternative managed pollinators. And I think another implication is that the benefits of insect pollinators will vary across the different varieties. So depending on what variety a farmer is planting, he or she may be more dependent on insect pollinators. And so I think those are two of the main implications. A third implication, just more related to native wild bees in general, is that for sunflowers in North America, these bees may be more effective and abundant pollinators than managed honeybees. So we tend to focus a lot on managed honeybees, and you hear a lot about honeybee declines and conserving or helping honeybees. But for sunflowers in particular, native wild bees are doing a lot of the pollination, and they may be better pollinators. These are bees that have evolved with sunflowers. They're native to the same region. As I mentioned, there are specialists of sunflowers, so they really prefer sunflower and will visit them. And so for this particular crop, we really need to focus on native wild bees and enhancing pollination by native wild bees, and maybe not necessarily honeybees, because they seem to be less important.
Are wild bee populations doing okay?
That really depends on which species, and it is hard because there are so many species of native wild bees. In North America, that could be close to 5,000 species,
wow.
Somewhere between 4,000 and 5,000. And we know that some species are declining, unfortunately. For other species, we don't know how they're doing. And then some species tend to be doing okay. And I always think of this in terms of the sort of weedy species, like weedy plants. Some will do really well with human disturbance. They'll grow anywhere. They'll do just fine regardless. And others are more sensitive. And I think this is true for bees and for most organisms. So some species do appear to be declining. We know that some species are declining. Others seem to be doing okay with human disturbance and other events.
Sure. For future research, you kind of touched a little bit on that, but do you have any other research goals in the future?
One of the goals, I think, for sunflowers in particular, would be to determine why some of these varieties seem more attractive to bees. So we found that bee visitation rates varied across these varieties. Why is that? Do some produce more nectar, more pollen? Do they have a color, a visual appearance that is more attractive? Do they produce a scent that's more attractive? So I think all of those are interesting questions. And one end goal could be breeding sunflowers to make them more attractive. So we breed sunflowers for all different traits, but the focus has generally, historically, not been breeding them to be more attractive to bees. And that might be one interesting direction to go in.
How different do they look? I mean, is it pretty small differences between them or larger?
Yeah, so I would say that they're pretty significant. And of course, it depends on how much time you spend with them. But the color can vary. So some can have more of a reddish purple pigment than others. Others are more uniformly yellow. The morphology, shape, and size of them can differ as well. So some of them produce flower tubes or corollas that are longer than others. And that's the part of the flower that the bee has to put its proboscis or its tongue into to get the nectar. So some of these flower tubes are longer than others. Another thing that really affects appearance too is some are more susceptible to diseases and pests. So I would say when I'm out there in the field, yes, some varieties look very different than others. Some of that is due to susceptibility to pests and diseases, which will of course affect appearance. But there's a lot of different ways in which they vary in terms of color, shape, etc.
Great. I interrupted you. You were going to tell me more about future research.
Right. So another area of future research is to investigate why some of these varieties seem to be better at self-pollinating than others. So part of it is that some varieties are more attractive to bees, and so they're going to get better pollination. But another difference is that some varieties seem better at producing seed set in the absence of bees or pollinators. So they're better at self-pollinating. And we don't really know exactly why that is. And there are a lot of different factors that can affect self-pollination and selfing rates. So investigating which of those factors are most important, why some varieties are better at setting seed in the absence of insect pollinators, I think that's an important area for research. And then finally, more broadly, and a sort of more applied question would be, how can we enhance pollination through crop management? So, for example, if farmers plant floral resources that bloom before sunflowers, can they bring bees into the field that then stay for sunflower bloom and do better pollination? Or if farmers integrate other floral resources throughout their farm, can they enhance bee abundance overall throughout that farm or around that farm to result in better pollination? How do pesticide practices, pesticide spraying, how does that affect the population of bees on farm or around the farm? So all of these different management practices that could affect bee populations, I think, could be studied for the end goal of coming up with management recommendations that would increase insect pollination.
Yeah, for sure. For you specifically, are you leaning towards one or more of these categories in your work?
Yeah, so I'm unfortunately not probably going to be doing much more with sunflowers in particular because I've moved to Florida and sunflowers aren't really grown here. But all three of those questions are interesting and could be studied in Florida ecosystems. The first question, why are some varieties or some plant genotypes more attractive to pollinators and receive better pollination? That is one that I'm interested in studying in blueberries in Florida, which is a crop that is dependent on pollinators. And then that other area of research, which is to examine management practices and how we can enhance pollination through changing management practices, I think that is also an interesting area to study in Florida, particularly with blueberries and also with strawberries, which are also somewhat dependent on pollinators to set fruit. And the strawberry fields may be situated in different landscapes, and they may have different management practices that affect pollination. So those two areas of research, why are some plants more attractive to pollinators than others, and how can we manage crops for increased insect pollination, those are the two that I would be more likely to focus on here in Florida and that I've started doing some research on.
Great. That sounds delicious and exciting.
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun to work in a crop that you can eat right away.
Yeah, for sure. Do you go in the grocery store and you're like, yeah, I helped do that?
Yeah. Although I don't buy at least strawberries. We're at about the end of strawberry harvest season now. And so I haven't bought strawberries in the store for a while because we've just had so many strawberries around our house. And I think blueberry harvest should start pretty soon here too. So we're just going to go from one berry crop to the next.
Well, that's great.
Yeah.
All right. I have three questions left for you.
Okay.
The first one is, if people want to learn more about pollinators and sunflowers, where can they go?
So for pollinators, there are a few different places that have great resources. One is the Xerces Society for Invertebrate Conservation. That's X-E-R-C-E-S. And they have a website with a lot of different information about bees and pollinators more broadly. A second great resource is the Pollinator Partnership. And they have a website, so if you just search for Pollinator Partnership, you can find their website. And they have some great resources. A third site that I'll mention, because it's more specific to sunflowers, is a really cool citizen science project called the Great Sunflower Project. And so if you're interested in doing some work with sunflowers, or rather some work with bees, and you like sunflowers, and maybe interested in having sunflowers in your backyard, check that out, the Great Sunflower Project. It's a really cool citizen science project.
That sounds great. How can people help with this issue?
That, I think, needs to be addressed or tackled at a few different levels. So we often talk about actions that people can take in their backyards, and I think that's important. But I also think it's important to remember that conservation really has to be done at broader national and state levels too. So I think first, making sure you're supporting conservation at those broader levels, either through donating money to or supporting conservation organizations with your time, supporting politicians that support conservation, making sure that you're focusing on conservation that is taking place at those broader national and state levels. In your backyard, though, there are things that you could do, which would include planting flowers that are attractive to bees. And those websites that I mentioned earlier, many of them have great lists of plants specific to different regions that are attractive to bees. Secondly, reduce pesticide use, particularly insecticides, and particularly on flowering plants. So if you can avoid spraying flowering plants with any kind of pesticide, that will help bees. And spread those messages to other people. Plant flowers that are attractive to bees and reduce pesticide use, especially on plants that are flowering.
Great. Yeah, that's good advice. Final question for you. What is one fun fact about you that people wouldn't know if all they had was your research?
Yeah, I was trying to think of what would be fun. There are many facts about me. So I love cross-country skiing. And I think, especially for people that meet me here in Florida, that's probably surprising. So I am Midwesterner. I'm a Minnesotan at heart. And I love snow. I love winter. I love cross-country skiing. If I could be anything other than a professor and a scientist, I'd love to be a professional or at least a competitive cross-country skier. And I'd love to live in an area with more snow, but I ended up in Florida, and there are a lot of great things about Florida, too, so making the best of it.
Sure. Maybe just take some trips.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, great. I'm so glad we had time to talk today. I love learning about your work and bees and all of these lovely things. So thank you for being on the show.
You're welcome. It was a pleasure talking with you.
you for listening to Field Lab Earth. You'll find a link to today's paper and other resources for this episode in our show notes or on our website. If you have any questions, comments, or recommendations for show topics, please contact us at podcast@sciencesocieties.org or on Twitter at @FieldLabEarth. If you'd like to hear more content like this, please subscribe, and don't forget to rate and review us on iTunes or anywhere else you find your podcast if you like our show. This podcast is a joint production of the Tri-Societies, the American Society of Agronomy, Crop Science Society of America, and Soil Science Society of America. Special thanks to Lobo Loco for the use of their song Spook Castle on the intro and outro of our show. Opinions and conclusions expressed by authors are their own and are not considered as those of the American Society of Agronomy, Crop Science Society of America, Soil Science Society of America, its staff, its members, or its advertisers.